Hello everyone, I am Sneha Prajapati and me and my friend Ananya Sridhar from Ashok and Rita Patel Institute of Physiotherapy going to discuss about the contextual factors affecting motor learning. So as we all know, there are a variety of factors, namely task characteristic, practice conditioning, then contextual factor, as well as type of feedback and its type can have impact on motor learning. So here we are going to start with the contextual factors which have impact on motor learning. So at the end of this session, you'll be able to know what are the contextual factors and what is the role of contextual factors in optimizing motor learning. So first we'll see what are the contextual factors. So WHO defined the contextual factors in the International Classification of Functioning, Health and Disability. The contextual factors represent the complex background of individual's life and living. It can be a range of factors that influence the health, safety, well-being, and participation in physical activity. These factors include social factors, personal factors, environmental factors, and psychological factors, which exist in different way and have varying impact across the population. So if we take one personal factor or one environmental factor, it can be facilitator for one, and the same factor can be inhibitory or impeding factor for other one. So these factors combining and have impact on motor relearning. So here we take the learning in relation to the normal population or the children with having health condition of the cerebral palsy who are not able to achieve the function at the normal phase. And we can take the relearning in relation to the population like stroke. So they have achieved the optimal learning and its outcome before, but due to some health conditioning, they are not able to reproduce it. So the first factor is the personal factor. So the first factor is motivation. The motivation can vary from task to task while performing any activity, and it can also vary to the condition. So according to the review published on 2016 on the optimizing performance through intrinsic motivation and attention for learning, it was inferred by the authors that motivational factors has the energization, direction, and as well as intensity of behavior. So the patient or any normal subject have the motivation to perform a particular task or learning a particular task, they are able to learn it more efficiently and can reproduce it more efficiently. And if the patient have lack of motivation, it can distract to the movement automaticity and circumstances. So we can see there are motivational factors which is divided into two parts, that is implicit and explicit. So implicit motivation is slow motivation, and it is taken by the conscious thinking. And explicit motivation is generally fast and unconsciously taken. So the both the factors, implicit and explicit motivation, have role in the learning. So here we'll see one clinical example. I have seen one patient who has recurrent stroke, and he was taking treatment for at least 1 year. He was able to move his upper limb, lower limb. He was able to follow command. He knows that he has to perform this activity. But when they asked the patient to do this activity, he was not doing. So what could be the reason? So if, we know that our motivation is seen in the relation of long-term goal and outcome. And in this patient, whenever he is learning any activity again or trying to do some activity. Initially, he was able to learn, he was able to perform, but due to recurrence, he is losing it again. So this have impact on his motivation that he is not able to achieve the long-term goal or outcome. So the motivational factors also have the influence in the motor learning, which can distract the patient to learn any new movement. The next factor is self-efficacy. As we all know, Pandura's self-efficacy theory, the self-efficacy is individual's belief and situation-specific confidence in prospective sense that he or she is able to affect the action that brings the task out. So if the patient have past successful experience or if you do not have, for example, the patient with spinal cord injury is coming to department and we are making him stand with the assistant or some devices, then on the next day, the patient was able to recall the successful experience of the past day, that the previous day he was able to stand with some support or assistance. And if we see the another patient with the same conditioning performing the same task, it can increase the confidence of the patient. And the confidence of the patient is the predictive of subsequent movement, and the subsequent movement goes into the positive direction. So it will increase the motor learning. So if the subject have past successful experience or is looking someone to perform the same activity, which can enhance the self-efficacy of them. And as the self-efficacy is high, the learning outcome is going into positive direction. The third factor is self-modeling. So what is self-modeling? Is looking ourselves to performing any particular task. So a review published on 1999 on self-modeling and relative intervention, and another review was published in 2012 on expanding theories of learning in relation to the self-modeling. They have concluded that the self-modeling results in the greater intrinsic motivation and as well as satisfaction with the learning and its performance. So if we ask the patient to take a video of any activity, for example, drinking a water, which is the basic activity in the lives. So if we ask the patient to take a video and observing how he is doing, what thing he is doing, what should be done, what should not be done, he is able to observe that. And by self, we can take the feedback that he is doing like this and can change the learning outcome and draw a positive conclusion. So next factor is perceived task difficulty. So perceived task difficulty is how a task perceived difficult by a subject. So according to the review published in 2007, the role of perception of task difficulty in relation of self-perception of ability, intrinsic value, attainment value, and performance, the author have inferred that the setting the criteria which indicates good performance inside of therapist, but can be reached easily by the patient, can increase the learner's expectancy. For example, we want to measure a balance in the subjects. So usually the balance decreasing with the age in normal population also. And if we ask one person that, if you are active, you are performing daily activity, you'll be able to perform this balance test easily. So the subject will perceive the task that he's able to do, it is easy. But instead of that, we are asking that you'll not able to do this, it is generally not completed by the other patient, it has various pores which is difficult to hold, then it will lead to perceived task very difficulty. So if the patient perceives the task is easy and it has the good performance, it can increase the learner's expectancy. The next factor is focus of attention. So attention is referred to the task and environment monitoring, scope and breadth of the physical and other cues relevant to the task performance. It is the skill or ability to control the concentration despite of conflicts of input or distraction, as well as concentration of the content regarding a particular relevant cues. So focus of attention can be divided into two parts, that is external and internal. In external, we are focusing on the outcome or goal which we have to achieve. And in the internal, we are focusing on the movement of body which needs to achieve that task. So to understand this, we'll perform one small activity. Okay. So the task is to lift the pen and hold it. Okay. The simple activity, we are holding any object like this. So this you have to perform into two ways according to command. So in the first way, what you have to do is you have to focus in your wrist, fingers and elbow movement, that how we are flexing the wrist, flexing the elbow, holding this, then extending the elbow, all things, the movements of the body you have to observe. So focus on the body movements. Okay. And in the second trial, what we need to do is we just have to focus on the outcome. And what is our outcome? So it is to hold the pen. Okay. So like this. Okay. So which one you found easy? So according to the review published on 2013, that the focus of attention and the motor learning, it was concluded by the author that external focus of control, which can help the subject to enhance learning, and internal focus of control, which is impeding the motor learning. So the second factors is psychological factors. So the first factors is anxiety. So as we all know that anxiety is feeling of worry, nervousness and uneasiness about the unpredictable or uncertain outcome. So according to the review published on 2016 on the perceptual motor learning benefits from the increased stress and anxiety, it says this, that when anxiety is increasing, it will decrease the people's flexibility to adapt change in task or any task structure during learning, and which makes the patient or adaptation to new learning more constrained and conservatory, which is not helpful for learning any new movement. For example, we ask patients, you have to perform the new movement. You have to do like this. You are not doing like this. You are doing it incorrectly. So it will increase the patient anxiety that if he'll able to perform good or not. So the flexibility to adapt the new change will be decreased and patient will not able to learn a new movement. The next factor is stress. So the same review said that the facilitatory and impairment both can be resulted by the stress. And the intensity of stress and duration of stress is also matter in relation to the learning outcome. So the stress can be acute stress or chronic stress. Acute stress is facilitating the learning and cognitive performance, because in acute stress, the patient feels like if he'll able to perform or not, he'll able to gain the result or not. So some amount of acute stress, which can be helpful. For example, in normal healthy individual, we have some stress before the completion of task, which ultimately help us to focusing on completing well in the task. So some amount of acute stress, which is helpful. But the same stress, if persist for chronic duration, so it is the chronic stress. So the subject feels the frustrated that regularly he is trying, he is not able to do. So it will impair the learning and same have detrimental effect in the learning memory. And another factor is emotion. So the influence of emotion on learning and memory, this was the article published on 2017, stated that if we have positive emotional states, which can enhance the activation of mirror neuron. And as we all know, mirror neuron is responsible for the new learning. So it will increase our learning. Also the positive emotional states, which can stimulate the selective attention towards the learning particular task. So we have increased likelihood to information to be stored. So here we have discussed the personal factors and psychological factors which can have impact on the motor learning.
Hello everyone, I'm Ananya Sridhar. We will now be discussing the environmental factors, the third contextual factor that is responsible for optimizing motor learning. So we are all beings in motion and we move from place to place for our livelihood, but we also learn to move skillfully. So any activity is a skill that we have learned or acquired over the years, and this responsive behavior is what we call as a motor skill. So these motor skills have been classified by Gentile's taxonomy. So in this taxonomy, the motor skills have been classified in relation to two important factors, which are the environmental context and the function of action. So we will now be focusing only on environmental context, and the environmental context has two characteristics based on which the motor skills are classified. So the two characteristics are regulatory condition and intertrial variability. So before moving on to these two characteristics, we will see what a closed and open skill is. So closed skills are those which are not affected by the environment, and obviously open skills are those which have and which happen in relation to the environment. So in regulatory conditions, we have a stationary environment and a motion environment. And in intertrial variability, the presence or absence of intertrial variability is there. So we will now look at simple examples in the therapeutic side so that we will be able to understand what is happening. So in for a closed skill in a stationary and no intertrial variability, we can the example can be, we can ask the patient with a stroke with an upper limb impairment to pick up a cup from the table and drink water. So there is no kind of an intertrial variability and the environment is also stationary. Moving on to the second category is stationary with intertrial variability. In this, we could say the example of where the therapist is giving multidirectional reach outs to the patient. So moving on to the open skills with motion and no intertrial variability, we can have this example of a patient whom we want to give training on the treadmill. So walking on a treadmill is where the environment is in motion with no intertrial variability. And then moving on to the last is motion with intertrial variability, wherein we can, the example can be when we ask a child with cerebral palsy or any other developmental disorder to walk on a foam surface which is cluttered with toys. So the child has to think through the path so that it does not fall over the objects, and it also has to, and the child also has to balance himself or herself. So moving on to motor learning and the environmental context. So we can see that in the early stages of learning, the learners will develop a general movement pattern, which then later becomes fine-tuned based on the environment context available. And also the learners use different sources of information in each environmental condition to learn the motor skill. So we can see that the environmental context has an effect on both the performance outcome and also the movements used during the skill acquisition. So hence, involvement of the environment in learning increases the performance outcome. So initially, when we begin with learning, we can keep the environmental complexity at a lower level. And as the time progresses, we can systematically increase the complexity so that we can have better results and learning. Now we will also be seeing the role of environment and the learning in happening in children, motor learning happening in children. So outdoor environments such as open spaces and parks stimulate motor learning in children. The environment and the social factors, family, play a key role in helping the child learn a new skill when he or she already has the preconditions but is not able to achieve it alone. So the environmental and the social factors, which we'll be looking at later, will help the child in learning a new skill. So the more the variation and the opportunity the environment provides, the more are the chances for the learning and development for the child. So we can say that, for example, when a child is provided opportunities in the environment, in in terms of toys or in terms of participation from the parent side, and also when the environment has challenges, the child will be able to learn more, and the child will also have the curiosity to explore more. So the more the variation and the more the potential, it means that there is a more potential for learning from the environment. And we can also say that the environment enables learning in children. This not only helps in developing a child in a physiologic manner, but also in a psychological, that is social, emotional manner. We will be now moving to the last contextual factor, which is the social factors. So as we can see here, the social factors are reflect different characteristics like the family, peer groups, which includes real relatives and also friends, the cultures and the different lifestyles. So all of these play a main role in motor learning. So regarding motor learning and social context, Jawad Afshari et al. In 2011, in their study, reported that competitiveness and peer presence increase the learning of a close skill. And the researchers also inferred that the absence of competition improved learning of open skill. So in this study by Jawad Afshari et al., they had three groups consisting one consisting of a competitive group, another of a non-competitive group, and third of a combined group. And all of these three groups were given a particular task for learning, and they were observed as to how the competitiveness resulted in changes in the result. So in the competitive group, all of the participants were informed of their ranks and about their performance as to how well they have performed. And by the end of each trial, they were actually ranked based on their performance. In the non-competitive group, they were not informed. And in the combined group, what happened is that initially, the first few trials were not given any feedback to the participants. But later on, in the last few trials, the feedback was given as the same as in a competitive group. So from this, they have concluded that the peer presence and competitiveness has increased the learning of a closed skill. And they have also added that the absence of competition has improved the learning of an open skill. So in another study by Wolf et al. In their theoretical review, they had discussed that social, that is peer presence, can act both ways. It can provide support and reassurance, but or can also induce pressure. So both of these facilitating and impeding influences can improve learning. Now we will be seeing about social factors and learning occurring in children. So in children, motor development and learning are influenced by some essential factors, such as the participation of parents in the growth of the child, the family's environment, the relationship between the parents and the family's culture and socioeconomic status. There are also many other factors like the participation of the parents in the child's routine, the child's access to leisure activities such as availability of toys or availability of the environment that is required, the intelligent quotient of the mother. Here specifically they have mentioned mother because the mother gets to spend more time with the child, and the educational level of the parents also. So research shows that the absence or irregularity in the said factors can hamper the learning of a skill in the child. So from this, we can conclude that both environmental and social contextual factors play an quintessential role in the process of motor learning or relearning. So all of these factors that we have discussed have to be taken into consideration to achieve optimal motor learning.